did you ever drink beer in high school?
No, not beer, but I do remember having a bag of mushrooms in my refrigerator. And I remember you mentioned your dog.
Yeah.
I had a cat, and my cat used to sneak into the refrigerator and he would steal the mushrooms. And I said, no, and his name was Lewis. I said, Lewis, you can't do that. You can't do that. It's not right. He ate them voraciously. He just loved them. It was like catnip to him. So I thought, well, what the heck? I better do it with him. And I remember lying in my bed for hours, and Lewis was on the desk across from the bed for hours, staring at each other. Not moving. Occasionally he would go, meow. But he would stare at me, and I had no doubt that he was my brother.
Wow.
But having said that, I don't do any of that stuff anymore.
Oh, my God. That is such a story.
It is a story. And you know what? And the other thing, later in life, when I was completely not doing any of that, I know he said hi to me. I used to work late. I would come home late from work, and to give him a little treat, I'd bring him a little can of sardines, and he would start eating it, and be like, and he'd make little sounds and let me know he enjoyed it. He'd go, meow, 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 meow. Well, that's great. I'm really glad you like it, Lewis. Hi, Lewis. Hi. And he looked up at me and went, hi.
Wow.
It's a true story.
Crazy evil.
Welcome to Speak All Evil, the podcast you were warned about. I'm Trent, here with Kat, Kevin, and Dave. Hello.
Hi.
Hello.
Hello.
We're back.
Finally back.
Woo!
Kat is back. Hello, Kat.
Hi. I missed you guys so much.
You did not.
I did
you
too.
Did not.
Well, you missed us, but you did not miss the movies we watched or the episodes that we did about.
You've been taking some holiday time. I feel like you've been maybe abusing these holidays. You took Christmas, New Year's, Flag Day, Boxing Day, National Bulldog Day. You don't even have a bulldog.
They're cute, though. They're little meatballs.
We're gonna dig out the HR manual.
Oh, I am HR of here.
We talked about it one of the other many times you were gone this year, and I thought that you would end up working the holidays. I thought the rest of us would be off. We could take some time off once the holidays roll around, and you'd have to pick up the slack. But you just took more time off.
I mean, if you guys want me to go solo for a week or two, good luck.
That's the only thing that scares me about this podcast is the thought of you going solo.
I'm just glad you guys had an opportunity to get all the disgusting depravity out of your systems before I
don't think
back.
I would be able to face you week after week in the last three that we just did. I do not think I could.
I definitely would have walked out. I would have walked out of my apartment and stopped watching whatever movies you guys watched because I tried listening to the episodes without me, and I was like, I don't really want to hear about poop anymore. I'm all set.
It's like when someone shows you pictures, you just flip through to the ones that you're in, and I skip past all the
other ones. Yeah.
Even I must say, I've kind of had enough just for now. We'll be back, I'm sure. But yeah, I'm happy to be out of the filth bucket for a minute. What have people been watching outside of what we're going to talk about this week? Anybody have any hot tips for us? Any recommendations outside of what we're going to talk about this week?
I've been watching some 80s slashers that are like way under the radar. I feel like what's happening now in music where it's like super oversaturated. I feel like the 80s was like that when VHS came out. Everything was super oversaturated. And I feel like, you know, years from now, we'll be discovering music that came out this year that we didn't even know about because 5 billion people put out music this year, or movies too. I mean, it really extends to any art, but I feel like the 80s, you just can't keep up with all the stuff that came out in that time. And I'm still watching stuff that either triggers some weird nostalgia, like, oh my God, I saw this when I was 7 and this scares me and it's not even scary, or stuff that I'm just discovering for the first time. So I watched a Bigfoot movie called Night of the Demon, not to be confused with Night of the Demons.
That's the 50s one, right?
No, it's not quite that old. It's early 80s, but it looks 70s because they're cameras from the 70s.
Okay, yeah.
It looks like a made-for-TV movie from the 80s. That was not great. I watched a movie called Girls' Night Out, which I believe that it's like when we watch some of the trauma stuff, like the Toxic Avenger, you could tell people are on cocaine because it's the 80s. I felt like this movie, you could tell that the people acting were on cocaine. And then today, to unfavorable reviews from some of the other people, I put on Death Spa, which mm-hmm. I thought was a very commendable slasher movie set in a health spa. So you have all the different things in the health spa killing people, you know, exercise machines and saunas and tanning beds. So I really like that. And I've also been digging into some, I got some Spanish stuff for you guys coming up.
Great.
That I've been trying to curate a nice Spanish week of some stuff. One that's kind of under the radar and one that's kind of mainstream and a little more fucked up than you'd expect a mainstream movie to be. But Kevin, you have been in quarantine. So I know you have. You said that your vision was all messed up, but did you watch any extracurricular horror movies after our Trilogy of Filth?
Yeah, well, during. I kind of had to fit these in there. It was, I could watch, like, you know, the TV was far away, and that was fine. It was more like opening a laptop screen or, like, an iPad or, like, too much iPhone screen.
Anything work-related, really.
Yeah, it was weird. Yeah, anything to do with work. But no, yeah, I watched a lot, and during my time quarantining, I was leaning more towards some TV shows. So I watched, Dave had recommended, what is it, Station 11, the HBO Max show,
right.
Which, you know, is like horror adjacent. It's definitely...
Dystopia.
Yeah, it's heading there, and I love that. I would definitely recommend that. I'm a few episodes behind now. But in anticipation of the new Scream movie coming out this Friday... Well, on the day this episode drops,
I bet you've been
drops,
watching every Scream movie.
I don't need to watch the first one because, other than the Texas Chainsaw Massacre and maybe E.T., I think that's the movie I've seen the most times in my entire life.
Okay.
So, my daughter and I started with Scream 2, and then went through Scream 3 and Scream 4. We're prepped for the new one coming out. I'm so excited. I love the reviews, or, you know, like the non-spoiler reviews that are coming out. But one TV show that I watched when I was quarantining is, it's on, I think, Peacock or Paramount Plus. It's on one of like the major networks. It's called Evil. And it's a good show. It's a good horror show. Definitely dealing with like theology and science. But one of the lead characters, played by Katja Herbers, when I was looking the show up, she has a movie on Shudder right now called The Columnist. And it's like a black comedy. It is about a reporter who starts getting a whole bunch of shit from people on social media. And, you know, she's a mother, a wife, seemingly very well adjusted, and she gets tired of all this and just goes out and decides that she's going to handle this herself. I would highly recommend it. It's a quick watch. It's like 80 minutes or something. It's on Shudder if you have it. But it's so good, and she is awesome in both the show Evil and in this movie. It's incredible. So that's what I've been up to.
This week, talking about Nicolas Cage.
Woo!
To step away from the realm that we've been in for the past few weeks, wanted to get a little bit more mainstream, maybe. I don't know if I would call either of the movies we're going to talk about this week mainstream. We call him Nick. Mm. No stranger to the horror film. We talked about the movie Mom and Dad from a few years ago, which I really liked. I think I liked it more than you guys.
Love that one.
I love that, too.
Oh, you did? Yeah. Okay. With Selma Blair also. We've mentioned the Wicker Man remake that he was in. Real bad. We didn't really get into that. And he's done some others, particularly in the past few years. He's been really on a roll with horror and like horror adjacent or like sort of horror. So we're going to talk about a couple straight out full genre horror movies that Nick has done very recently, beginning with, I guess we're going to start with The Color Out of Space.
Mm-hmm. Do I have to set up
is
both movies?
Yeah,
I didn't know I had to set up both movies.
Yeah, well, you would have known that if you listened to any of the past three episodes.
Okay.
Let me get the manual.
Wow.
I got it. Okay. Okay, real quick.
Like, why did you look to Kevin?
Because I thought why,
Kevin's going to throw you a lifeline.
I thought he got... I didn't pick this one. Doesn't matter.
If you all want right. a lifeline, I'll
Kevin's
give you
Kevin's always
one.
Surprised me. Nope, set up his own picks.
I'm on
to set up yours.
Death line. We got to have that.
I like to use a death line.
All right. Color of Space, directed by...
the title, first of all.
Color Out of Space.
Oh, fuck. Great.
Would be the title of this one.
Do a tough start.
Oh, my God.
This couldn't have gone any better, actually.
Color Out of Space, from Richard Stanley, directing an H.P. Lovecraft, a short story. This film is about Nicolas Cage and his beautiful little family. They live on his dead father's farm. His wife has recently had a cancer situation. I think she had like a mastectomy or something like that. She's recovering from this procedure, working from home. Nicolas Cage is really horny for alpacas, apparently. He's got all these little, you know, animals rolling around. He's trying to play farmer, keep his little cute little family together. One evening, a meteorite comes from the sky, lands on their farm, and shit gets weird. It gets a little, there's a lot of colors. I honestly did not really know what was going on for most of it, if I'm being honest. I was constantly a little concerned and confused. I know it's supposed to be, you know, spacey and trippy and Lovecraftian and whatnot, but I just really wasn't feeling this one. Maybe just because compared to the other film this week, I held in such high regard after watching it for the first time. At first, I was like, okay, space meteor. It's going to mess with this cute little family. I'm down. Like, I'm down for some aliens. But then the fusing scene happened for me, and I was just like, no, thank you, please. In a human centipede kind of way, I really just didn't really want to watch it anymore. I think that kind of body horror just really, really messed with me. Maybe it's because I took a few weeks off and I didn't have to watch any depravity for a little while. I don't know. It just didn't really seem interesting to me, like the whole plot. I think it could have been a shorter film. It was like 2 hours long. This is a short story from H.P. Lovecraft. I don't know. I did like Nick Cage. You know, we got to experience a little bit of Cage rage in this. Love the cute little Tommy Chong cameo. G-Spot, the pussy cat, was a cute little character. So the acting itself was great. I'm just not really into Lovecraft as a person / writer. I did see his grave when I went to Providence.
Oh, wow. That's exciting.
It was about as interesting as this movie was.
Oh, just as like, I am Providence or something.
Yeah, it's just it's just a patch of ground. I wouldn't.
Exactly.
What do you want?
Nothing. But I just don't know what it. They never really explained what it was. What was the color out of the color of the space? I don't know the name of the film. Was it radiation? Was it alien sickness? Was it bad drugs? Who knows? Who cares? Not me. I will say, it was a visually appealing film. The colors were nice. The nature shots were cool. Other than that, I'm just really happy to be back this week, you guys.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So Trent and I were texting a little bit about this movie, The Color Out of Space, and we were talking about how we were looking forward to watching it again because both of us had sort of watched it, maybe not paying full attention to it. Because I know I had watched this before, and I'm using air quotes. I had watched this before in a very distracted...
You know how you watch movies now. You've really come yourself. Clean about like all the things you do.
I was mowing the lawn.
While you're
shoveling the driveway, like shoveling with one hand and my iPhones in the other. But this one, no, I felt the same way that you did. So I'm sad for you that you only get to watch this the one time. Because upon a second viewing with my full attention, this movie is great. You mentioned the acting's good, and I think that there's a lot of depth here. I agree with you, Kat. H.P. Lovecraft is a very difficult character that has so many movies, and I mean, I'm wearing my Reanimator shirt tonight. There's so many adaptations that are beloved by the horror community, but he's a very difficult character to go back and read about and understand. I mean, he was a horrible racist. He was
not a great dude.
This story was written in 1927, which is insane. But for me, you mentioned the acting. And this is a rare modern horror movie where you have a huge star, or at least a recognizable actor like Nick Cage. And then he's surrounded by very lesser known actors. And I loved it. I loved everybody in the family. I love the pacing of this movie, the fact that this meteor lands in their on their farm, and the wife, like you talked about, Teresa, played by Jolie Richardson, which we talked about in the Event Horizon space episode that we did. She's really the only other than Tommy Chong, recognizable person in the film. But like, just the fact that like the meteor lands, Nick Cage is trying to farm and grow peaches and things, and she's like a day trader or something, and she's trying to get like Wi-Fi out at this farm, and like the slow way that they have this meteor start to affect not just the land but the animals and the water and then the people. I love it. I don't think that you're right, and that we don't totally get I think we get full Cage rage in this one.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, it's just not for like that as long. It's not for that long. It's not like a continuous rampage of Cage rage.
No, but this this is one that I think if you looked it up a little bit, you would maybe be a little trepidatious about liking it, knowing that it's Lovecraft, who is questionable, Richard Stanley.
Hatecraft.
Who is questionable.
More like.
Richard Stanley's questionable?
Yes. So Richard Stanley, this is the first movie that he had done in like 20-something years.
Island of Dr. Moreau?
Since he was booted off of Island of Dr. Moreau. He was kicked off of that.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Okay. And uncredited. And this Colorado Space was supposed to be a Lovecraft trilogy from Stanley.
Yeah, I saw that.
And as they were ramping up for the second film, his partner, who co-wrote Colorado Space with him, came forth with domestic abuse allegations.
Oh,
and,
wow.
RLJE, his production company, XYZ Films, everybody just cut ties with him.
Huh.
So Stanley went from like a 25-year hiatus to a big comeback to being canceled pretty fast. But anyway, I mean, before I pass it on to Dave and we can kind of like go around the room a bunch, I enjoyed the hell out of this movie the second time watching it and really paying attention to it. It's a slow burn. It is long, but I feel like when it really gets going that there's so many really clever things that the actors, the writers that Stanley did that pay homage, not just to other Lovecraft things that we know, you know, like the Necronomicon shows up. But there's also just really great homages to The Thing and to The Fog and to a bunch of other movies that like we all know and love. This movie is one of the most, I was telling Dave earlier before we started recording, this movie is so researchable that I got bored and decided to just stop researching it. Because I would literally talk for 40 minutes tonight about all the Easter eggs and things that are put in this movie that are just very subtle and very clever. And I appreciate that as a horror fan. And I don't want to come off as like some know-it-all. Like right now, we're watching it right now, just the Miskatonic University shirt that Ward is wearing is a callback to Reanimator. So there's a lot into this movie that you can like really dig into. But like Kat said, there's also a lot that I found like very emotional in terms of the family. There's a lot to dig into here, I think, in the dynamics of watching a family completely fall apart. And to your point that I will agree with, Kat, you don't even know why. But there's a family being like ripped apart for no, they never explain it to you. So anyway, Dave.
I was calling this Alpacalypse Now because you have alpacas that go wild and they turn all, they become one giant. I don't know if you guys know about the Rat King. The Rat King, a bunch of rats get all tangled together and they travel around as one giant bundle of rats. That's what happens when these fusings happen, is you get stuck with, like if it were to happen here, we would all be globbed together, which I would cherish.
Who would be the head?
We'd all have heads.
Who would direct? Who would direct?
Here we are. We're
being
back at the human centipede again. No, trying no. to. not it.
Oh, but, I'll be the head. Who's the caboose? Yeah. Is the more important question.
Well,
that would be me.
This movie did not. I watched it twice, and neither time did it hit. I couldn't exactly describe why it didn't fully hit for me, but I love Nicolas Cage. I thought he was great in it. It wasn't his fault. But I love his evolution, like, as an actor, because he started out as like the really awkward nerd in everything that he played in like his 20s. And then his 30-somethings, he was just kind of like sad and depressing.
He was like winning and then his Academy 40s, Awards.
Well, right.
Then, like,
that's true. But I mean, his characters. In his 40s, he was like this hulking action hero.
Right. He's
and then
many
now
incarnations.
We're yeah. in the era that I like the best, besides for the nerd one way back, is like the horror absurdist weirdo movies. Like, I feel like he takes scripts and signs on to movies that kind of make them happen, probably. Like, as soon as Nick Cage decides he's going to do a movie, that brings some of these movies to life. And I think this movie could have been better. I think it's cool that they did a H.P. Lovecraft thing, because he's one of the horror guys and the cosmic horror. And there was really great body horror in this. I love all the stuff the pets got fused together and all this crazy stuff, and they had this glowing
magenta
skin, which was all kind of, you know, it was all kind of great. There was no bad special effects. There's nothing that I absolutely hated, but just something about the pacing of this movie didn't quite do it for me. I wanted to like it so much, and it did keep my attention, but it kind of reminds me of I don't know. It's almost too much of a family movie.
Yes, I agree.
Yeah. Okay.
I agree.
I liked that about it, though.
I've changed my mind on this a couple times. I saw this in the theater, and I didn't really know what to make of it. And I don't know. I wasn't,
what theater? Like, the Nick?
This was at the Nick.
I remember you told me
nice.
About
it. Yeah, and I wasn't really sure what I thought. And then, so I was excited to revisit it. And then I watched it again, and I was like, oh, man, this is great. That was... After that was when I talked to you, Kevin. I had already seen it again. And then I watched it again after that, and then I changed my mind again. I don't think this is not, I don't like this movie. I don't think it's very good. There are things that I really like about it. It's not a terrible movie by any means, but I think it was like done kind of wrong. And I think that Nick Cage has the right idea in this, because especially the setup, like the first half of this movie, it comes off to me like kind of a budget TV show. Like from the aughts or something. Like, this is like budget Gilmore Girls, it feels like, or something. Except that Nick Cage is doing this, like, I don't know, he kind of seems like, because they're living at his dad's cabin. They moved there, not a cabin, but his like place in the woods. They moved there because of the cancer that his wife has. And I think that, Kat, you mentioned like the point, I think the point that's like not being made that well here is that it's supposed to be some sort of like parallel. The color out of space is supposed to be kind of like a parallel to the cancer, and that's what's tearing the family apart is that the mother is dying of cancer, and that's kind of supposed to be, I think, like some kind of metaphor with the color out of space, and that's what's disintegrating the family. And I was interested to read that Richard Stanley made this movie in part because his mom died of cancer, and they used to read The Color Out of Space together. Like, he would read H.P. Lovecraft to her.
Okay.
So I think that's one of the things that isn't really that clear when you watch this, because the tone is like, I don't know. Yeah. Again, I just thought it was like TV. But then Nick Cage is acting like he's in like a camping movie with John Candy or something, like the whole time. He's doing this like black comedy kind of vibe to everything, but he's the only one doing it. So he's kind of like, I thought he was not that much different than he is in Mom and Dad. But everyone around him is being like super like dramatic, like TV style. And it's like, what's going on with this movie? It's kind of weird. Once it kicks in, I think once things start going crazy, then it doesn't really matter so much, like, because everything is going so crazy. I did like, you know, once the cell phones aren't working, and once they start losing track of time, Like, they don't know if it's been an hour.
I like that part of
it. That was really scary. I thought that kind of started to get scary. Like, I have anxiety dreams about, like, your phone stops working, you can't call people and stuff. Like, that was scary. And they're like, I don't know how long it's been. Did I take the alpacas out or not? How many times have I taken them out? You know, that was, like, very trippy, you know? But I thought that my prescription for this movie would have been not to necessarily cut it down, because the story needs some time. Like, you can't really... You can't just do this story, I don't think, in 80 minutes. Like, it's not that easy. But I just think it should have been done differently. I would have started this movie with a family asleep all through the house in the middle of the night.
Mm-hmm.
Boom. The comet, the meteor, whatever it is, comes down. And boom, that would have disrupted everything. Title card. And then I would have gone, like, right from there instead of all this, like, I don't know. This is on Shudder. I think it's worth seeing.
Well, I mean, we've talked about this before. We talked about The Beach House.
Very similar.
I think it was the Patreon.
And that was a great, indie.
Based on the same thing.
Yes. We talked about The Beach House.
Yeah, we did.
Yeah, that was one we all did.
Yeah.
But there was also the Creepshow.
Yeah, Jules.
Stephen King.
Undeniable similarity to Creepshow and Tommyknockers. I found out, I was watching this and I was thinking, like, this reminds me
call.
Of... When I was watching it, I kept thinking, this seems like a Stephen King adaptation or something. And then I read later that Color Out of Space was one of his influences for the Tommyknockers, which
great
I did.
Book.
I've read
terrible
that.
Movie. Yeah. Great book. Terrible movie.
Very similar story. So that makes sense.
Well, I mean, I think I'm going to disagree with all of that and say that that's why I think it's good, is the family element is good. So the stuff that you're talking about, Trent, where you're like, it's a little like Gilmore Girls or whatever, I think that's what makes this work. I connected to every single one of these characters. Like, I loved Lavinia, the daughter. And, you know, so Nick Cage, you know, Nathan Gardner, which, I mean, haha.
Right.
The last name is
Gardner. Gardners.
Yeah. The Gardners. and Teresa, the mom and dad. They have Lavinia, their daughter. They have Benny, their son. And they have Jack, who is their young son. I thought every single one of these people absolutely killed it. And, like, you know, the scene where things are really going bad and Lavinia is carving, like, Farthic runes into her body, which harkens back to, like, Midsummer. Like, that's the language that they were speaking there. Like, there were just a lot of, like, really good scenes. There's a scene where, like, Nick Cage is going Nick Cage and being over the top, which you're saying you liked about this. And in the movie, you know, his wife, Teresa, is seemingly oblivious most of the time. I mean, there's a vegetable chopping scene.
Classic vegetable chopping.
Really good.
Yes.
Well done. It is cliche. It's been done, but it's good.
You have to have that. Sure.
There's a scene where he comes into the house and he is screaming and going Cage rage and is like, that fucking smell, because there's that, ever since the meteor landed, like, there's this smell that, like, nobody else is acknowledging except for him, and he's like, it smells like the inside of, like, the ward where, like, my dad died of cancer, and you should know more about cancer.
Oh,
like,
it's, that was brutal.
There's
that
some,
was
like,
brutal scene.
Really, really powerful scenes that are, I think, maybe lost along some of the imagery that Stanley was, like, very well pulling off. Like, to your point, Dave, there are no bad effects in this and everything, but, like, it may be a little bit too cut up and stylized to get some of the emotional scenes. But watching it a second time, giving it my full attention, Trent, maybe you did yourself a disservice by watching a third time.
I should have just stuck with the second time. Yeah.
but the second time, I pulled a lot of threads out of this. And to be honest, I had read a little bit, Trent, about how, like, where Stanley was coming from and where some of, you know, maybe Lovecraft's story was being twisted a little bit away from some of his original things. But I don't know. I thought this was good, and I'm never the guy that's like, I want to sit down and watch a 2-hour movie. And I agree with you, man. Like, you couldn't have shortened this up. You couldn't have taken anything
really,
out of this.
Yeah.
Like, and
you
made
just
it
could have
work.
Done it better, in my opinion.
I think the only way you do this movie better is you go full Spielberg with it. Like, it was not quite family friendly as Close Encounters, but it wasn't like there was a few body horror parts, but you barely saw them. Yeah, I felt like it could have gone one way or the other.
Yeah.
Like, either go more family and have me actually care about the whole family and what's going to happen, or mm-hmm. just make it a splatter fest.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, and when I compare it to like family TV, I just mean in terms of the production, the way that it looks and the acting performances. Well, I don't mean that, you know.
The opening with her on the horse doing the whipping spell or whatever.
That was strange.
Yeah, a little bit the craft. No offense, Kat.
Hey, that was my favorite part of the movie, basically. I was like, oh, fuck yeah, this is going to be great.
He's like, was that Wiccan or Alexandrian?
Oh, fuck off. I don't even know what any of that means. Anyway.
They should have gone on a picnic. A pack of lunch.
Maybe I could have done with a nice second watch for this one, because I feel like if I had picked up on all that, you know, the nuances, if you will, of, you know, the
you didn't even catch the title.
Yeah, apparently. I've been doing too many dabs lately. It must be what's happening. Sorry. I don't know. Maybe if I had picked up on all these subtle things, like maybe if it had drawn me in a little bit more for me to want to pay more attention to what was going on, then perhaps I would have appreciated the film a bit more.
One thing that I loved that Nick Cage did in this that I didn't catch right away is that there's a scene early in the movie where he does an impersonation of his deceased father, like berating him, like putting him down. And he kind of does this voice like that's what his dad was like, saying that he's a loser and he'll never be a painter and this and that. And then later in the movie, when he starts like freaking out and he's doing more of his Cage thing because the color has like gotten to him, it's affecting everyone. They start acting weird and he starts having these outbursts of rage and stuff. I was wondering like, why does he like keep doing this kind of like accent when he gets mad? He almost takes on this kind of weird accent when he's yelling at them. He's doing his dad. It's the same accent he used for his dad in the beginning of the movie.
That. Good call.
That's why, because he's like turning into his dad. I think there's a lot of that stuff in this that I think is a little bit lost because, I don't know,
right.
I didn't think it was executed that great, but I thought that was cool.
Do you think it wasn't executed great because of Nicolas Cage or because of
everyone else.
Everyone. Okay. I'm just curious.
I think everyone should have acted more like Nick Cage, and I think it shouldn't have tried to be so serious. I would have leaned into his instinct was to go more black comedy, and that's what I would have done.
I really think they did. I think that, like, you know, Jolie Richardson as Teresa, I think she did that a bunch. Like, I thought that her scene with the finger chopping, with the vegetable chopping, I thought that was great.
But we've seen that, like, if somebody goes into the kitchen and they start chopping real hard and they chop harder and faster and harder and faster and they get a dazed look in their eyes, look out, because they are about to chop off their fingers.
We knew what was going to happen, but I thought that, like, literally the scene where she turns around and is like, dinner's ready.
She holds up the fingers.
That was a really good performance. Yeah, I thought Lavinia had a bunch of performance. I thought Lavinia had a bunch of good scenes like that.
You know, it's not good in continuity there. Those are raw chopped carrots. Dinner is certainly not fucking ready. I mean, she's going to like dice them smaller if they're going to be in a salad.
Raw salad.
I did enjoy how the color starts taking over the landscape around the house, and it starts small with like the little, like, is it magenta? Is it, Kevin? Is that the color here?
Magenta.
Yeah, all these flowers start blooming around the house, and gradually the whole landscape around the house starts turning magenta, just like the vegetation. I thought that was creepy. I thought there were a lot of good things about it. I thought one thing that was weird, the daughter, what's her name, Lativia?
Lavinia.
Lavinia. Didn't you think she was a little young for the surveyor guy?
Yep, that was weird.
That was weird.
I mean, that guy's hot.
She's supposed to be like 16, though.
Yep, I get
and
it. Like,
the surveyor guy comes around to survey the water, and she's like taking him by the hand and leading him around.
Like, smooch
and,
or
and
anything?
And her mom is like, oh, you have a crush on that. You know, there's that whole scene. That was odd.
Yeah, that was like some slut shaming that was going on mid-show.
Yeah, I didn't get that.
By the parents, but I thought like the movie was actually making a good point about how somebody like a character like Ward, who is clearly older,
that's the guy,
educated,
the survey guy,
could protect and care for someone like Lavinia in a non-sexual way. I don't think he was trying to get into her pants.
Well, she has a copy of the Necronomicon. We've talked about that, and I've seen that copy, the little paperback Necronomicon thing. That was like, by the time I was old enough to see that, I wasn't interested anymore. But she has a copy of the Necronomicon. She's doing these rituals. She starts cutting herself all up at one point, which doesn't bother her for the rest of the movie after that somehow. I guess she's in the grip of the color or whatever, so she doesn't care that she's you know, done this.
No, she's like actually carving spells into her to protect
her.
Just a couple like little things. Ward Phillips that we talked about. He's the hydrologist that you talked about. HP actually stands for Howard Phillips. Howard Phillips Lovecraft. So Ward Phillips.
Okay.
Was one of the more like big. There's a ton of Easter eggs, like I said, in this.
Yep.
That goes to Lovecraft, his past. Colin Stetson did the music for this. We've talked about him because he did the music for Hereditary. And he's a multi-instrumentalist that we talked about in the Hereditary episode, when he's done a ton of stuff. He's worked with like Bon Iver and a ton of artists. But he also did the music for the new Texas Chainsaw Massacre, which comes out on February 18th on Netflix. So I think we're all pretty excited.
You might be.
We're anticipating it.
I've noticed that Fede Alvarez's name has diminished gradually over time. We'll talk about that later.
Yeah.
Nobody has mentioned Tommy Chong.
Tommy Chong was fantastic in this.
I mentioned it.
Yeah. I mean, he was fantastic in this.
I liked his final scene the best.
My favorite thing about Tommy Chong in this movie, he plays a squatter that's on their land out in the woods. He's a super hippy-dippy, like ultra-hippy guy out in the woods living off the grid, and he's kind of a little bit of a harbinger in this. But he's such a hippie that he calls coffee Java. Not one time, but twice in the movie. They're like, do you guys want some Java, man? Like, oh, he's a hippie. I get it.
I remember all my life, raining down as cold as ice. Shadows of a man, a face through a window, crying in the night. The night goes in. Just another day. Happy people pass my way.
My real pick for Nicolas Cage week this week was Mandy. Fuck yeah. This is a Panos Cosmatos' 2018 psychedelic tale of a quiet logger named Red and his wife Mandy, who lived a life of serenity in their dream cabin in the woods. That is, until the leader of a deranged cult titled the Children of the New Dawn becomes enamored with Red's wife. The cult then kidnaps and terrorizes the couple, leaving Red spiraling into madness. The psychedelic journey goes full grindhouse as Red, armed with a battle axe and an array of drugs that he finds at his fingertips, goes on a violent rampage and exacting his revenge on the cult in the most gruesome of ways. I'm upset that I've gone the 3 years since this film has been released without seeing it.
Mm.
If I'm being honest with you guys, I know I can be honest and open in this safe space.
Yes.
To be honest, my ex was always trying to get me to watch this movie. And then it got to the point where we started the podcast and I'm like, okay, now I'm not watching it specifically, so I can save it for the pod. And I'm very glad that I did. Then, when I had free reign to choose this week after the depravity trilogy that everyone just experienced, I knew what I had to do. So now, I have finally watched Mandy, and yes, I absolutely loved it. It was just the amount of revenge and rampage that I was looking for. Nick Cage fucking killed it in this one, especially during my favorite scene, the booze chugging and screaming scene, which I feel like we've all related to. You can just feel his torment. This is definitely one of my favorite recent Nicolas Cage roles, for sure. Obviously, the cult leader character, Jeremiah, is a trash person. He seems like the kind of guy who can't get laid normally, so he had to start an LSD sex cult in order to get some.
That works.
And it works. Works for him. Works for other people. His whole scene with Mandy in the house reminded me of that quote about when it comes to the opposite sex, men's biggest fear is that women will laugh at them, and women's biggest fear is that men will kill them, which I think is accurately depicted in this movie for sure. And then there's the trippy editing of their faces overlaid upon one another. It's very cool, very unnerving, but very like mesmerizing at the same time. I feel like all the editing in this was great. I basically just wish I had taken drugs before watching both of the movies this week. I think that was my big downfall. I only did weed. I only did the marijuana. So I feel like I really could have hit it a little bit heavier. But all the chainsaw fights and gore and knife penises were great. It was just a really well done, drug-fueled rampage. And I just really loved it.
I love this movie.
Woo!
So much. I loved it the first time, and I was excited to see it again. I love it even more now. I kind of like lived in this movie for a couple of days. This reminded me a lot of one of my favorite movies or series of movies, the Mad Max movies of the early 80s. This reminded me of like Mad Max meets Hellraiser on acid. I loved the Black Skulls, the gang, the acid biker gang. They were, that was the Hellraiser part to me. They were like the Cenobites.
Cenobites?
Whoa, that was good.
If you just put Pinhead on a bike, that first scene when they show up, and it's showing them like in the dark, and they're all on their like four wheelers and motorcycles and stuff, and it shows the guy who's like all spikes. I was like, "What?
He's all spikes.
What is going on?" Man, this is so good. I just love how it creates its own universe where the Black Skulls really exist, and this this cult, the Children of the New Dawn, really exist, and they're all out. This is like supposed to, I think, take place on the West Coast, or it's in California, right? The Smoky Mountains.
I think it's like upper northwest.
It's like Utah, Montana. No, it's
California, because the mountains that they name, the mountain range, is real. It's not the Smoky Mountains. What are they? Where does it? The title card says
Shadow Mountains.
Shadow Mountains. Thank you, Dave. Thank you. Yeah, the Shadow Mountains are real. Yeah, they're in California, so it all takes place out there. I love the 80s vibe, like late 70s. It's supposed to take place in 83. Mm-hmm. You have Ronald Reagan on the radio doing his whole speech about like pornography and stuff. And you have that amazing house where they live out in the middle of the woods that's like so 70s. It's just like all like that kind of that color wood and like windows and stuff. I don't know what more I can say other than I love this movie.
Well, I did not like this movie the first time I saw it. I thought that it was like all style and no content. And then this time when I watched the movie, I feel like you kind of either have to like submit to its pace and its vibe and its aesthetic, because it's completely different than anything you've seen. It's even different than Panos?
Cosmatos.
Yeah, he did the Black Rainbow movie there, which is kind of similar style. Beyond the Black Rainbow. It's kind of similar stylistically. This is obviously like much bigger production. But this time I watched it, I absolutely loved it. There's nothing consistent or continuous stylistically, but that's what I liked this time. It was like where everything is stylized and every scene is its own statement. So rather than watching it for like continuity between scenes and any kind of, you know, thing that makes you comfortable, you just have to go into that world. And I read a thing about this director that he used to do when he first started writing when he was a kid that I really connected to. As he said, he'd go to video stores and his parents wouldn't let him rent the movies, so he would just look at the cover and he would imagine what the stories were based on the title and the artwork on the cover. And I used to do that when I couldn't afford CDs, and I would go to the record store and I would really want to get the new album by, you know, the Red Hot Chili Peppers when it came out, and I couldn't imagine what it was going to sound like. And then I would read the song titles and I'd go home and I'd think about them and I would come up with these ideas of what the songs would be, and they would never be as good as and like the real song was never as good as what I had imagined it would be. So much like It Follows, I took this as like this dreamlike state or this like imaginary state, almost like a Wes Anderson movie that creates a world that's like slightly off kilter from reality, but you don't have to suspend your disbelief that much. It's too extreme as far as, you know, believability. But yeah, I thought it was great this time. I loved how the different chapters were separated with these really cool like title cards. Like it was like,
love that.
It's very like, I don't know, like music video in a good way. It's very rock and roll. We had talked earlier about the quote in the beginning by the death row inmate. There's lots of little things in this, including the cult leader's penis, which I was surprised. I thought that was why people... I'm so confused about cults now that I'm learning from you guys about masculine inadequacies and all this stuff. That, like, I thought that he would have a large penis, and that's why the people would want to follow him. But he has a small penis, and he's insecure, and he's shitty.
He's probably a grower, not a shower.
He just makes them listen to his records all the time.
Oh, my God.
Like that part. That reminded me of me. That reminded me of me.
Hey, babe, listen to this. It was a very Charles Manson situation, for sure.
The Carpenters are good. This is even better. That's me. I love that part.
This is one of the most simplest plots that we've ever covered on the show.
Well, that's the thing about revenge, is it sets a stage for, like, a lot of times the movie Revenge that we watched recently also was stylized like crazy. And I think it's such a simple plot. You know what's going to happen, basically, or you know what they're going to try to do. And from there, it's like you just sit back and you watch it unfold and you know... If it's a revenge story, there's not going to be some crazy twist or whatever. It's just going to be people going at it.
It's Red and Mandy. It's Andrea Riseborough as Mandy, which we talked about in Possessor, which is one of our top movies of 2020. There's definitely some backstory there. There's some things they're hinting at. And like we're watching the movie now, and Linus Roach that plays Jeremiah Sands is horrible. He's horrible in this. It's one of those... performances where you're never going to look at this character again or this actor again and not think of how horrible he is if you've seen Mandy. It's very stylized. This is a heavy metal. This is a metal horror movie.
Definitely.
Like, this is definitely like if you wanted to watch a movie and listen to Slayer at the same time.
Yeah.
That's Mandy.
There's even that title card, the title card that's Mandy. It turns Slayer, into like a black metal Exodus logo.
Yep. Yeah, and it doesn't even come in until an hour and like 15 minutes into the movie, which I love. Dave, you mentioned like you didn't like the pacing of Colorado Space, but I think that the pacing of Mandy is actually very similar to the Colorado Space. And you don't get a whole lot into Mandy. Like you don't really get a whole lot of action until an hour into this, which is yet another 2 hour long movie. I think you get better Rage Cage in this one for sure, for obvious reasons. The dude has some really fucked up things done to him and the love of his life. And then somehow he now knows how to smythe and he knows how to, hunt down, Cenobites.
Wait, did you say he knows how to what?
Smythe.
Is that sword making?
You mean smith?
Because that was a great part.
Yeah, and he does it just in sunglasses. He doesn't have to wear like a shield. I don't think you can do that.
It's the 80s.
Just wearing sunglasses, I think you have to wear.
No,
like
I mean, this movie is an acid trip.
I don't know. But these hippies that live out in the middle of nowhere, I've seen these people, and they're likely to be like, hey, let me show you something, brother. I make swords in the back. I make bombs, but check out what else I made.
They were like, I'll smoke you up back here.
Yeah.
And also, and by the way, swords. Let me show you my sword making.
Yeah, it's like, all right, bro. Cool.
How the fuck do these cults get started? Who follows this dude?
He only has like five followers.
But
it's
how do
a
you,
small cult.
It's very, it's very Manson-esque for sure.
Yeah.
Like he
yeah.
plays a song.
He's basically bitter that the record companies didn't want to make him famous. So he's somehow amassed this group of like 4 to 5 people.
I've had people ask me to be in cults before.
No.
I have.
No.
Multiple times.
Multiple?
I had neighbors that escaped from 2 different cults. They're a husband and wife.
What?
Yeah. And but they weren't even the ones that asked me to be in the cult. I think they wanted me to start a cult. But yeah, like the hippie scene and stuff. That's where it starts. I feel like it all comes from like the hippie scene, and that's why I like this like heavy metal hippie vibe to this movie, because it gets really weird and you feel like you're tripping in a lot of this, especially the scene, Kat, you're talking about the Michael Jackson black and white face going back and forth. That part was really cool and psychedelic. I thought everything was so tastefully done. Every single effect, as gaudy as it was just the right amount.
Mm-hmm. Well, it's not only like trippy to watch, but a lot of this movie is about acid.
Right.
Everyone in this movie is on acid because the cult and this Black Skull motorcycle gang, they all kind of deal with this acid maker, this like obscure out in the crazy mad scientist acid maker, and he has dosed the Black Skull gang.
The chemist.
Yeah, the chemist has dosed the gang with some kind of crazy drug that's kind of like part of why they're out in the woods and they're so crazy. It's turned them into like total sadists.
They love
and
pain.
The acid comes in like a giant beaker, and it looks like a green shake. It looks like some sort of protein shake that you would make at home, right. And they just guzzle it.
It's an avocado smoothie.
It looks like an avocado smoothie, and
it's
they
like,
just
yeah, it's a metaphor for like Starbucks.
It. Yeah, and then when you get to their place where the Black Skulls lived, I don't know if you guys noticed like how much they like Chinese takeout. The whole kitchen is all Chinese takeout. That's
Same.
Where the reality...
I like they're watching porn.
Yeah, that's
oh,
where it gets
course,
like really
yeah.
gritty. Yeah.
But also, what's up with like them dropping the acid in Mandy's eye and then pulling a wasp?
That's awesome. That's a real wasp.
A gigantic
yeah.
wasp.
Yeah, well, not the wasp in the movie.
The size of like a baseball.
It's a Florida wasp, right?
And,
no.
And stinging her with that.
Yeah, yeah. That's that wasp actually exists. It's like... a South African wasp or something. I don't remember, but I read about it, but that they grow to like 3 inches or something.
To circle back to the chemist scene, I thought the chemist himself was one of the most likable characters in
Richard
this
Brake.
Movie. He was great, and I think what struck me the most about that scene is he was basically just having a monologue because Nick Cage didn't say anything that entire scene. The chemist basically just like read what Nick Cage was thinking and just said it out loud and then released his tiger into the world. I thought that scene was
yeah,
yeah
was
that
great.
Was great. Yeah.
I wouldn't say powerful, Lizzie. But I thought it was a very good scene.
Tiger's name was Lizzie.
Oh man, they did you wrong.
Yeah. It's like, yeah, obviously.
That's how I do. So it rolls up here like covered in blood. Like they did you wrong, brother.
The Black Skulls really suck at securing their captives.
Really bad.
I noticed. They're not
really
good.
Bad.
They're good at getting the captive. They can mm-hmm. kidnap you very easy, but they can't hold you that good. I mean, people are escaping all over through this movie. I thought that it didn't take much to
they must have
get the upper hand.
That much peripheral vision.
They have all the masks on.
Right.
They're high on this acid, and there's like a whole pile of cocaine in their... they live like in a trailer.
They like it. After the kill with Nicolas Cage is a big bump mm-hmm. before.
It's bump. Well, like Kate,
it's so real. Hinting. It's just like, oh, he's just a white trash dude that lives in a like in the middle of the woods, and he's just gonna fucking.
They're
get
hinting
all
the whole time that like Nick Cage is like recovering.
Yes,
and there's like hints
yes.
that he was like, because this is 1983, like you said,
he turns down the beer
that he's like a nom vet.
Yes,
and
a reaper,
and then he just starts like. Boozing and taking huge amounts of cocaine, and it's just like
acid.
I mean, yeah, it's.
I loved the scene where Red just dips his finger in the avocado shake acid, and he just like barely touches it to his tongue, and immediately goes on like the
craziest
trip.
Well, the bathroom scene that Kat was talking about. I mean, he's guzzling booze and then pouring booze on a wound.
Mm-hmm.
And like, and even in the previous movie we talked about, Color Out of Space, there's a scene where he has like this scaly skin. He's starting to like succumb to the color, and he dips his fingers in the bourbon and just rubs it.
Yeah,
on his
yeah,
arm.
Right. Yeah,
like
yeah.
there's a lot of parallels to like his performances in these two movies.
Did anyone think of Antichrist when Mandy comes upon the dead fawn? In the woods.
Mm.
Oh,
I thought
call.
That was very.
I did not, but yeah, good
very
call.
Chaos reigns.
I thought that the barbed wire gag and hand restraints. Mm. I was really surprised. I was like, wow, something I've not seen in a horror movie before. You see the barbed wire?
It's very theological. Like.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. The
they had barbed wire back in BC or AD or whatever.
Well, the Crown of Thorns would be the barbed wire.
Ace Hardware back in Zero?
Do you guys have a favorite planet? Because they talk about, there's a little bit of like Earth, a cosmic horror in this. Earth. Kevin, do you have a favorite planet?
Pluto.
Cat?
Uranus.
Oh!
Oh! It's a butt joke.
I can't believe it took that long.
2 seconds.
They talk about their favorite planets in this, and no spoiler, but there is the other thing that I love about this. It's hinted that this is like essentially cosmic horror at some point in the movie. And I love
the ending for sure.
It's so otherworldly, but at the same time, it's still so gritty. It's still like trailers and Chinese takeout and piles of cocaine and bad acid. But at the same time, it does get you into this like trippy kind of otherworldly stuff.
I love the groveling of the cult leader at the end.
Oh, yes.
The mix between high posting, high posting, and then like, I'll suck your dick.
I'll give you a blowjob. I don't care.
Did you guys see Menace to Society?
Yeah.
Same exact scene as Menace to Society when the crackhead is begging the guy.
I'll suck your dick for a cheeseburger.
That must be a direct reference. He must have seen that movie.
I will say there are, well, I think there's that very iconic scene where he's just screaming, "You ripped my shirt," over and over again. Because love it's that really sad moment where he's taken Mandy's shirt, the 44, and
that was
put
his
it
shirt.
On. But she was wearing it. Like.
They show the flashback where he's wearing that shirt when he first meets her.
But then that was the one she was wearing when she got kidnapped.
Right.
And then they took it off, and you know, the things happened.
Yes.
So it was just that moment where he's just running through, just cocained out. You ripped my shirt. You ripped my. That's my favorite shirt. He's just like screaming. But I will say, I think the scariest thing about this movie, maybe the most horrific, was the shag carpet in the bathroom.
I thought the scariest thing in this movie was the cheddar goblin.
Oh, the cheddar goblin!
Was that real? There's a TV commercial for real. The cheddar goblin.
Yeah, because when he goes to see Carruthers and get the crossbow, there's a box of cheddar goblin mac and cheese.
I feel like he was still, even though he went to see the guy that is... it's a very stereotypical character that doesn't want to talk to anybody, stay away, and then
he
goes
inside. He's got fuck you on his door.
He's got fuck you on the door. And he gets in there, and he's the only guy that's okay to get through. And, like, the weapons, I feel like he was ill-equipped. He had two arrows.
I know.
And he made a weird axe. It took him. It must have taken him two or three days to make this axe.
No, it was like 2 or 3 minutes.
Quick montage.
It was quick, but I mean, I felt some time elapsed there. And then he just goes with this axe, which he does use very well.
He does these two arrows. Yeah.
I will say, Trent, I was with you on thinking that the cheddar goblin was a real thing.
I didn't know.
Because
if it was.
When I was watching it with Nick, where we watched it together, it was very romantic.
Good.
I was like, when does this movie take place? Was it like the 70s or 80s? I was like, Cheddar Goblin's on the TV. When did that happen? And he looks at me and he's like, that's not a real thing. He's like, that's for the movie. And I'm like, oh, no. 83.
It was 83.
No, that's when it came out.
I didn't know that Cosmatos, his dad, made a whole bunch of movies. And I think, Kevin, you and I talked about Senior Cosmatos on the Patreon when we talked about Leviathan. His dad made Leviathan.
Really?
What?
His dad was a sculptor. His dad made First Blood.
Wow.
No, the second one, Rambo 2.
Oh, I'm sorry. His dad made Rambo.
It was the over-the-top one.
Yeah.
Was it the humble, like, in hiding the tree?
Yeah, no, his dad made Rambo, First Blood Part 2, and a bunch of other action movies. So he comes from...
The other Stallone one, Cobra.
And that's where Carruthers. That's what Carruthers was in, like, I think, Cobra or Commando, maybe?
He also made Tombstone.
Yes.
Wow.
Tombstone's great.
Yeah, so this guy comes from... some serious film background.
The music on this was done by Johan Johansson. This was the last film that he scored before he died. And it was taking a whole bunch of drugs and flu medicine. And he died very young in 2018. He did a whole bunch of movie scores, but Mother was one of them. I also love the fact that in Mandy, like when they're trying to figure out where she lives, and she gives it up by saying, "Oh yeah, we live down by Crystal Lake."
Ah, that was great. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Really good. Really good horror Easter egg.
You mentioned the new upcoming Texas Chainsaw Massacre. The older woman of the cult in this movie, the cult hag,
is playing Sally Hardesty.
She plays Sally Hardesty in the new Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
You mean Glenn Close but no cigar?
Oh,
again?
Son of a bitch.
The biggest thing about Mandy is I love the movie, but I honestly think that making... This is one of the few movies I've watched where I think that making the movie would have been more fun than watching the movie.
I would say this is one of my favorites of the past few years. And this is on Shudder right now, as well as The Color Out of Space. So you could watch both movies on Shudder. They're both on VOD also as well.